I'm Lucky Sherpa. I have been working with the Member of Parliament Rains, not only in Nepal, but with the entire regions of the world, focusing more on the indigenous issues, the indigenous parliamentarians issues, and of course focusing more on the indigenous women as well. The indigenous peoples in Nepal are somehow 37.5% of the total population. But their participation as per their population is very minimal. Overall, the indigenous peoples of Nepal are facing the religious, cultural, linguistic and educational discrimination for the last 240 years due to the movements of indigenous peoples and also the struggle of the many other political parties who are in favor of indigenous peoples issues. Now, presently, there is a provision that 32% of indigenous parliamentarians has to be in consent-making process. So I think presently we have an inclusive parliament. We just had an elections, and we have around 29% of indigenous parliamentarians in the parliament, and now we have left 26 nominated. Many parliamentarians are still not aware about indigenous peoples' issues. And of course, the quota system, the affirmative action system is quite effective in terms of making the indigenous parliamentarians who have been discriminated for so many years to brought into the politics, to make them aware about the different scenarios, to make them aware about their influence in the national legislation and policy making bodies. I think this will really enhance their capacity in dealing the issues more properly and more effectively, I believe. In the present Constituent Assembly, right now we haven't yet formed any caucuses. But past Constituent Assembly, we used to have an indigenous caucus. We used to have a women caucus where the parliamentarians used to gather and talk on those particular issues and make kind of activities or plan to how to deal with that issues in particular, you know, in most of the cross-cutting thematic areas where we are going to have a legislation, where we are going to have a new draft documents of the policy. So we used to discuss how we can articulate these issues into these documents. So at that point, it is not only one party, but cross-party alliances used to be built, which was very strong. Like, for example, the political parties have different principles, different ideologies, but while it comes regarding the indigenous issues, while it comes regarding the women issues, irrespective of different political parties, different political ideologies, you used to get together. So I think this is a very good procedure, and we are very much hopeful that this time also we are going to have those caucuses. We bring back those caucuses, indigenous, of women, of Dalit communities, and we will try to make it happen, the policies friendly to us. But still, it gives a kind of pressure to them. There is a kind of quota system in parliaments, and that drawbacks to them that we have to be inclusive. A little bit of informal kind of pressure is there. So they used to try to bring some women, some indigenous in their own political structure. It is of course very difficult for a woman to run the parliamentary elections because political structure is not that much women friendly. And for indigenous women, it is much more difficult, I believe, because we don't have that kind of policies which can specific focus, giving focus to the women during the electoral process, where the women lack resources, women lack money, and women lack even power. I believe scenario have a little bit changed because these days women themselves are a little bit aware about the political situations. But the thing is, you know, the grassroots communities, they still are not that much aware on the issues, but somehow they are a little bit sensitive towards women, you know, giving a little bit priority towards the women candidate. But it's still, it's so politicized that they don't care about women. They don't care about indigenous candidate. They just care about money, who provides lots of resources during the election time, and which is quite difficult for a, particularly for a woman, to have that kind of environment. So I think it is quite hard for a woman to lead during the election time. But still, many women have already been elected and they have become a parliamentary. And for me also, as a woman, of course, I've faced many challenges. Like if women are educated and if women tends to be a little bit smarter than men, and then the men leadership, they feel a little bit inferior. They start to react accordingly. And this makes them hinder, you know, the women to get a little bit step back than men. So there isn't any kind of encouraging trends, you know, encouraging trends for a woman in South Asia to involve in politics, whether you have to be a family member of the political leaders, or whether you have to be a daughter of the party chairman, you know. So it's very difficult, yeah, because you are able, you have talent, you have education, but that's not the qualities that is required in the South Asian politics. You don't get any specific support. You don't get, being a woman, you'll never get. You have to create your own, you have to compete, you have to let the men know that you are more capable than one, you know, male counterparts. So you have to prove, you know, you have to prove that you are better than men. And then only you will get the electoral candidacy. Otherwise it could be very difficult to get electoral candidacy also. I was leading the Indigenous Peoples Movement, and I was leading the social movement of women. And more you can say, I was a civil society activist. But while it comes of writing a new constitution for our country, what I felt is, you know, we have been raising hundreds of issues through different civil society movement, which gets very few used to get recognition. But I believe the political institution is one of the institutions where we can really put forward our issues and build accordingly. Therefore, I have been encouraged to join politics. And I have joined the politics, and I have been elected as a member of Constituent Assembly. And chances are that it has really given me a kind of platform where I have united the indigenous parliamentarians within our own country, provide them a kind of experience that I have previously regarding the UN Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples, regarding ILO 169. I used to provide them all this information to the parliamentarians who are there in my own country, focusing more, provide them a kind of training, a kind of capacity building, a kind of information sharing programs, which was really good. And I have even brought few parliamentarians, indigenous parliamentarians, women parliamentarians, in the UN Permanent Forum on Indigenous Issues. So this is how you can make difference. These are the few little things that I have been doing with the parliamentarians in Nepal.